Hey guys, this is David Kwan here. Recently I made a video saying that having a logical debate or logical debate against people who are against gay marriage, who want to keep it illegal, is kind of impossible. And that's because the majority of the opponents of gay marriage are so emotionally and perhaps even religiously or morally invested into this debate that they actually just throw out whatever kind of excuses they could come up with in order to keep gay marriage illegal. So the whole crux of their argument is not to have a logical debate, but to bring out whatever points they could make to keep it illegal. That was pretty much the summary of that video I did. But here I am. Actually, I'm actually going to start talking about some of the all those arguments here. This topic will encompass multiple videos. Each video will tackle each argument. Of course, this first video is going to cover the most commonly used argument by the opponents of gay marriage. It's so commonly used, in fact, it was actually used in the recent Supreme Court case, the one about Proposition 8. It's interesting that the one about DOMA didn't use this argument at all. It stayed away from this argument. I think that's because it kind of really fell apart in the Supreme Court case on Prop 8. It just totally fell apart because it should. It's not a powerful argument, although it kind of seems like it does, maybe. And the argument kind of goes like this. The basic argument, this basic argument pretty much goes, hey, marriage should be between a man and a woman because a man and a woman in union can biologically, a woman in that relationship can be naturally pregnant, become naturally pregnant, and can procreate and have children. Marriage is there to encourage couples to procreate, to stick together as a family, and we have this entire family unit that is beneficial to all society. Gay people, as a couple, are not it's physically impossible for them to have biological pregnancy and to procreate. Therefore, marriage should be defined as between a man and a woman. So that's pretty much the basic argument that it's all about procreation. There's so many ways to kind of tackle this argument. The fact that marriage is more than procreation, but I like to kind of, I think the Supreme Court case on Proposition 8 was interesting because one of the court justices was like, well, in that case, should we ban all marriages, all straight marriages, heterosexual marriages, in which the couples are infertile or sterile? Should those marriages be annulled? So that's kind of the counter-argument, I guess, like rhetorical question against this argument. But I think it goes deeper, you know, because, okay, fine. Maybe it's best for society to you know, procreate or whatever. But is biological procreation the only option? Do gay people, when they marry, do they just be a couple, never have children, and that's it? And that's how their legacy ends? Usually, I don't know. I don't know about usually, but gay people have families. They have children. I mean, they don't, like, give birth naturally, you know, but they adopt. You know, that's a possibility. They do foster kids. They also do in vitro, you know, impregnation. They do surrogacy. There's so many methods where gay people do have children. And they fall in love just like straight people. You know, they fall in love with that same person of the same sex. And then they, you know, stick together. And then they decide to have a family together. So they adopt, or they do in vitro, or they do surrogacy. And then they raise that child. They raise that child as if that child is one of their own. And it pretty much is their child. So that becomes an entire family unit. So if this is possible, like, what is the argument about procreation? So this is when the opponents of gay marriage go a little bit nuanced, and they start bringing up studies. And they start bringing up studies where it compares the welfare of the children. Like, how do children fare raised under biological parents? And then how do children fare raised under non-biological parents? Most of the studies, the conclusion is that children raised under biological parents fare better. So this is the argument this is kind of the example they use. Hey, look, you know, kids under biological parents fare a lot better. Therefore, marriage should only be for, you know, people who can have biological children. Therefore, marriage should only be for straight people. So that's kind of thing. And it's interesting that the argument is pretty much like it's optimal for the children. Children fare better under biological parents. You know, it's optimal. We want to have the most optimal option. Government should only be supporting the optimal course for the children. The thing that's kind of irks me about this argument here is that, well, those studies are not actually all that relevant. Because most of the studies that's cited compare biological to non-biological. That's a very broad category there. Sure, biological parents, children raised under biological parents tend to fare better. That's a pretty, I agree with that conclusion. But this non-biological category includes so many things. You know, it also includes single, you know, children raised under single parent or a guardian. It's the non-biological category is so much bigger than gay married parents. And straight married parents. That's what the comparison needs to be in order to have this optimal for the children argument. And I'm not even sure if that argument is compelling enough. But if that's the argument, that's the study that's got to be cited. And most of the studies have just recently started. They're very recent because we now have states where gay marriage is legal. So now we can compare. Hey, this is how the children fare. Raised under straight married couple versus children raised under gay married couple. And what's the result? In most of the studies I looked at, there's no difference. In some cases, children raised under gay parents fare better. In some cases, they fare worse. In some cases, they fare not that different. There's no significant, conclusion to say, hey, children raised under straight married parents fare significantly better than children raised under gay married parents. There is no, so far, all the studies have not been able to show or prove that at all. They've been able to prove that biological parents or family members are better than non-biological. That's kind of proven at this point, but that's irrelevant. And also, even if it can be proven that, you know, it's optimal for children to be raised under straight married parents, even if that's the case, we got to look at the bigger picture. Because it's not only this debate is not only about the welfare of the children, it's also about the welfare of the society as a whole. We have an entire group of people. This is I know it's a small percentage of the population, but it's still a big, significant portion of the population. And that's all people who are gay and lesbian and bisexual and transgender, all those people, it's a huge group of people who are denied rights that come along with marriage. These people are harmed. If we look at what's optimal for the whole society, instead of just optimal for the children, because that's one small subset of society, if we look at the entire society as a whole, what is more optimal? To harm these people? To deny them of their rights? And so we have this humongous cost of discrimination, or to allow them gay marriage, and so they become integrated into society, and they raise families of their own, they have their children of their own, they have their rights, they're not taxed unfairly just because they're not defined as being married, they're not denied visitation rights, hospital rights, medical rights, just because they're not considered as married. What is more optimal for the whole society as a whole, instead of just optimal for the children? And that's kind of my counter argument to these arguments about procreation.